السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. The Quran is a divine book. You know that, I know that. Something amazing I'm going to start off my speech by is all the scriptures, all those who are following divine books that they call divine. You and I know that the Quran is the most authentic by virtue of it not having been changed at all. Nothing was changed. And some people argue, no, this was changed, that was changed. Bring your books that are proven to be changed by the masses of today, and it's being changed constantly. You will find the Quran goes back to the furthest point. Even if you think and you claim that it was changed, which we don't agree, you will always find that it goes back further than any other scripture, the point of argument. So if you say it was changed, we ask you, when was it changed? You'll come up with a date, perhaps, according to you, that would be far behind the dates of the other scriptures being tampered with. May Allah grant us the understanding that this is indeed a divine book. Another beautiful point. The Quran is the only heavenly book wherein you find Allah Almighty, or the one whose word it is, the one who revealed it, is addressing the messenger, and the message is for us. So he's addressing the messenger or addressing us. It's not a disciple talking. It's not someone else speaking. It's not a third party having compiled books and so on. The Quran has a uniqueness. And this is why those who've read the other scriptures, and I've read a lot of other scriptures, they would be able to tell immediately as they open the Quran that this is something unique because it has in it the direct addressing of the Maker himself. So because the Light Upon Light this year is themed upon the Quran and the divinity of the Quran, I started off by letting you know, indeed, it is an amazing book. It's the only book in existence that you can actually memorize from cover to cover without a single mistake. I know people who can read it, so many who can read it from cover to cover with all its stops and pauses and the different disciplines of learning within the recitation of the Quran, the translation of the Quran, without making a blunder. No other book, not even the short booklets that people write, no other book is memorized in that particular way. It's amazing. And Allah Almighty encourages all of us to make an effort to connect to His word. Why? Because you and I were created by the Creator. For us to succeed on earth, we need to connect with that Creator. And the only way to connect is by connecting ourselves with the word of the Creator, His message that came to us, primarily the Quran. And the Quran will lead you to following the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him. So understand that if you're part of the Ummah of the Quran, you're blessed. If you were to look at any other scripture that the followers might claim is our scripture or heavenly, so on, the Quran outshines all of them. And this is told even by the disbelievers from the time of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. You look at Al-Akhnas ibn Shuraiq, Abu Jahl, and the others who used to tiptoe in order to listen to the words, the beautiful, melodious recital of the Quran, the words of Allah. When they came back, at one point, they had to admit to say, you know what? It has a sweetness. It has a beauty. It has some amazing meaning. It is absolutely perfect linguistically, to the degree that the Arabs, after revelation of the Quran, began to use the Quran in order to correct their own language. Anyone who learns Arabic cannot avoid the Quranic verses, because a lot of the rules and regulations of Arabic derived from the Quran. Yet Arabic precedes the Quran. It is because the perfection of the language is indeed something worth noting.
from Allah, the word of Allah. The words of the Quran are amazing. Allah Almighty starts it in a unique way, even though the revelation of it through 23 years happened to be in a different order. And it's interesting to learn that order for purposes of understanding, for purposes of looking at how Islam and the rules that were laid down came about. But the worship of Allah and the recitation of the Quran in prayer or as an ibadah needs to be in the order of revelation. So it is Surah Al-Fatiha, and you read it as the surah, even if there are some verses of Surah Al-Baqarah that might have been revealed later on, but they appear earlier in the surah, you need to read it in a specific way. May Allah grant us a deep understanding. Now, did you know that every one of you seated here has contributed towards the protection of the word of Allah? Every one of you has contributed towards the protection of the word of Allah. You might want to know how. Do you know how? Let me explain. Who knows Surah Al-Fatiha? Put up your hand. Can we read it together? Repeat after me or with me, with me.
Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawmiddin, Iyaka Na'budu wa Iyaka Nasta'een, Ihdina الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين.
Who from amongst you does not know the Arabic language? Put up your hands high. High. That's the majority of you, mashallah. But what did you do? You read an entire surah of the Quran in Arabic, and I'm sure you know the meanings of those words, even though you don't speak Arabic. You don't really understand deeper Arabic, but some of these surahs, did you not make an effort to learn them the way they were revealed? If the answer is yes, congratulations, Allah used you to contribute towards the preservation of the Quran. People say, why do I have to read the Quran in Arabic in salah? When I stand up in prayer and I say Allahu Akbar, and I have to read verses of the Quran in Arabic, I get asked a question, can I not read in English? And the answer is, not in salah. In the prayer, you have to read the Arabic. And then the question comes, but why? The answer is, we are taught to adjust ourselves in order to understand the word of Allah, not to adjust the word of Allah for us to understand it. You need to contribute towards the preservation of the book. And when you do that, you will be protected by Allah. Look, if you want to be protected every morning, every evening, you need to read certain verses. Who can tell me the most important one? Say it loudly. There you go. Ayatul Kursi, right? Do we know Ayatul Kursi? Put up your hand. Oh, there, the yes came. Mashallah, everyone. I put up both hands because I know it twice. Mashallah. Okay. Ayatul Kursi, we know it. We know قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. Imagine when you read these verses, you are automatically protected, and wallahi you are. Now one wonders, how did Allah keep protection in repeating His words? Because the devil will never come close to you. Shaitan will never come to tamper with you. Jinn kind, jealousy will not bother you, affect you. Black magic will not bother you, affect you. Because what you have come with is something that created a solid protection around you. And this even the enemy bears witness regarding. Subhanallah. It's the word of Allah. And this is why when Allah says, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. We have revealed this reminder. We have revealed the Quran and we will protect it. It would mean if you made an effort to memorize it and it is in your heart, Allah has to protect you. Because you have the Quran in your heart, Allah will protect you. You don't need to fear anyone or anything. You have the Quran. So my brothers, my sisters, if you want to protect yourself and you want to improve in your confidence, you want to improve in your character and conduct, you must connect with the word of Allah. It does for you miracles, that which you may know, that which you may not know. And this is why Allah says, in this Quran and in its verses, in their meanings and in adopting what it says, you have cure for the diseases of the heart, cure for what lies within the rib cage or the chest. Allah Almighty has cure, both physical and spiritual, in verses of the Quran. Are you going to read the Quran? The difficulty is we don't connect with it. Soon there is a month of Ramadan. How many days remaining for Ramadan? Does anyone know? How many days remaining for Ramadan? Anyone know? 60, what else? 90, what else? Can I tell you? Beginning of March, that's when Ramadan is going to start, 2024, inshallah. I think the second week of March, right? Someone counted 73, I think they're right. 73, right? My brothers and sisters, that's the month of Ramadan coming. Many of us unfortunately connect with the Quran in the month of Ramadan, claiming that that is the month of the Quran. It is the month of the Quran in which the Quran was revealed. But Allah wants you to connect with the Quran for the entire year. Just like a person who's bothered about halal and haram only when Ramadan comes, but they're not bothered about halal and haram outside of Ramadan, that is a loss. That's a waste of time. You need to be bothered about halal and haram throughout the year, but more conscious of it in the month of Ramadan. So it should make you conscious of Allah, the book. Wallahi, I invite you this evening to do something amazing. We're ready for the invitation? Every day, start your day with at least a verse of the Quran. Did you hear what I said? I invite you to start your day with at least a verse of the Quran, at least one verse. Is it a good invitation? MashaAllah, we're all saying yes. Alhamdulillah. InshaAllah, we make use of the apps that are on our phones. I'm sure we all have apps on our phones that have the Quran. Am I right? It's written there so that we can read. There is an app I know, Quranly. It actually counts for you. It counts for you a lot of the rewards and so on. Although you would be rewarded more than that based on your intention, but this is just the basic that's promised to you by Allah. And on top of that, it shows you the others who are also reading Quran in your contacts and how much they are reading every day, and you can compete with each other in a good way. So that's just one, but there are so many other apps. The difficulty is we have at times multiple apps on our phones. We haven't made use of them. And then we say, you know what, I'm a Muslim, I'm connected to Allah. The first basic thing is the Quran, connect with it. Then say, I'm a Muslim, inshallah, I will follow as best as I can. Then we're speaking. But if you're saying I'm a Muslim and you're not connected with the Quran, there is something wrong. You need to improve. I need to improve too. So start your day with a verse of the Quran. And inshallah, if you do that, your life will change. Firstly, you can recite it. You can look into its meaning. You can ask questions if you don't understand. You can look into reasons of revelation. You can look into rules and regulations and so much more. One verse. I tell you, the Quran has many miracles that come with it. Those who say, I don't have time to read the Quran and see how Allah gives you more time in your day. He blesses your day such that when you've read Quran in that day, you will have a lot of time. The Quran creates its own time for you because it's the word of Allah. If you're dedicated, don't ever say, I don't have time to read the Quran. You say, no matter what, I'm going to read the Quran and then see how Allah gives you blessings in your time so that you can achieve so much through that day. And then another miracle of the Quran is when you start with one verse, you won't be able to continue just with one verse. It will continue to two and then three and then four and then more. So you end up reading a whole page a day. You end up reading more and then you start memorizing things. You know, I'm always baffled by how people, they want their kids at a very young age to learn every song that there is in the market. Whatever song is on Spotify, Dotify, whatever other fi there is, everyone's learnt it. And they learn the moves of the same songs on which app? On which app? Don't pretend like you don't know. TikTok, there goes, mashallah. You see, we learn the moves. But I tell you what, without realizing that I could have spent my time learning verses of the Quran, when you have a little kid, the first things that you put into the sponge, it is taken in and absorbed more than anything else, and the life is being molded at that point. So when your life is being molded and whatever you're absorbing happens to be divorced from Allah and the message that Allah has given us, what do you expect as an outcome? Rather, we let the child absorb beautiful recital of the Quran. Recently, I came across a lovely reciter by the name of Muhammad al-Faqih from Yemen. Have you heard that name? No. You can check him out. A young guy. And subhanAllah, beautiful, melodious recital. I swear I could sit all night and hear the entire Quran, listen to it and concentrate. That's how beautiful the recital is. People ask me, who's your favorite reader? Can you guys say a few names? Who's your favorite reciter? Just call out names. Abdul Basit Mu'aykili. Who else? Mushari. Who else? Afa. Who else? Anas Al-Imadi. Who else? Look at all the names, mashallah. Beautiful, right? I have a different favorite reciter in different moods. How's that one? I promise you, and I'm not cheating, by the way. Sometimes you listen to so many Haytham al-Dakhin, for example, Hazza al-Blushi, for example, this guy, Muhammad al-Faqih, I'm talking about, a guy known as Ra'ad al-Kurdi, a guy known, so many reciters, one after the other. There are tons and tons of them available. And wallahi, I tell you, depending on your mood, each one will help you by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to calm down, to soothe, to fulfill that within you that needs fulfilling, because you are connected with the Quran just by listening. Imagine if you are reading. Imagine if you try to read with a melodious tone. I once told some people, a gathering, that you must make an effort to read with a melody. So one of the ladies messaged me later and told me, it's so difficult to read with a melody. I said, you have to, you must. It's only you. It's only you in your room. But instead of looking at the Quran and saying, ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين الذين يؤمنون بالغيب. It's not wrong to do that, but Allah wants you to beautify it. ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين. See the difference? Amazing. And the sister tells me about 2 weeks later that I can't believe the contentment I feel. I'm happy. I'm so happy. I was sad and depressed. I look forward to reading the word of Allah and telling Allah, oh Allah, for you I'm doing this. Listen. Listen to this. Subhanallah. May Allah Almighty grant us ease. I remember one day I traveled with a certain brother and he sings nasheeds. And someone came up to him and told him, I know your nasheed, can I sing it for you? And he says, okay. And this little child singing the nasheed exactly the way the singer sings. And the child was excited, the parents were excited, the singer was extremely happy, and we were sitting there enjoying the moment. Something struck me later on. I said, imagine you and I sitting in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, I learned your word, I know the words, I want to... It's not a song, so it's not a matter of singing. I want to recite them for you alone in the best possible way. Imagine how that would be. See, are you ready to do that, inshallah? Wallahi, it will change your life. We're talking about the Quran today. We still have a few more days. Those of you who may not be able to attend the Light Upon Light events in the next few days, you can watch it online, inshallah. But you'll see a continuation of what we started off here today in Manchester. By the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my brothers and sisters, the Quran has in it shifa.
Ya ayyuha an-nas qad ja'atkum maw'idhatun min rabbikum wa shifa'un lima fis sudur وهدى ورحمة للمؤمنين.
Guidance and mercy for believers, that's in the Quran. A reminder from Allah The light from Allah, the guidance from Allah, shifa from Allah, cure for that which is in the chest. Subhanallah. All this from Allah. Reminder, Allah reminds you to do good things. Do you know anything that Allah has prohibited cannot benefit you? And anything that Allah has made an obligation has to be beneficial and will never harm you. So if Allah tells you, you need to stay away from X, Y, and Z, you do not participate in X, Y, and Z so that you can lead a beautiful life. Sometimes you may not understand immediately why Allah Almighty prohibited this. Sometimes you might falter and fall into X or Y or Z or both or three, all three of them or two of them. That doesn't mean that you are disconnected from Allah, for as long as you know that Allah has prohibited this and I should not be doing it, but human weakness made me falter, let me quickly come up and seek the forgiveness of Allah. You sought the forgiveness of Allah, you came back up and Allah says, you're back on track, don't falter again. But that's Allah. When Allah says something, it's because it's good for you, the way He said it. You might understand later on, there are so many things that we are looking at today and we realize the Quran is the truth. Today, we have thousands of people looking at the Quran, scrutinizing the words. Non-Muslims, people who probably hated Islam not too long ago, but because of what's happening in Palestine, and we pause for a moment to say, oh Allah, help our brothers and sisters in Palestine. Oh Allah, grant them victory, grant them mercy, grant them goodness, grant them safety, grant them security. Oh Allah, we ask you to be there for them because we are so weak, we can barely be there for them. May Allah Almighty forgive our shortcomings and may Allah Almighty strengthen the Ummah so that we can stand up truly for our brothers and sisters who are struggling in Palestine. Ameen, Ya Rabbal Alameen. But if you look at what happened there, it caused an interest in the Quran and in Islam. So many people began to look at it from the non-Muslims, and guess what? They started turning to Islam in their thousands. Yet we who are predominantly born Muslims do not value the Quran. We don't value this message. You find these people coming and saying, you know what? I found something amazing. The Quran has answered my question. The Quran, wow, the Quran has spoken this and spoken that. We haven't even gone through its meanings. We should be embarrassed. We should be ashamed. And it's a fact. Because if you don't know the meanings of the Quran and you were born a Muslim and today you're 20 or 30 or 40 years old, you have indeed wasted your life. You don't know the most important book, the most important message in existence, you don't even know it. May Allah strengthen all of us. That's why I started off by saying we are going to read one verse a what? A day. One verse a minimum. Beyond that, inshallah, Allah will take you and we will float and we will go ahead. My brothers and sisters, the Quran is a miracle. If you read a single letter of the Quran, you earn rewards, 10 rewards minimum. As you go more and more, you're getting more reward, more reward. The Quran has in it an amazing, unique power. The Quran has in it something that is inexplicable. You need to read it in order to feel it. And you will realize this is indeed the gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَيَرْفَعُ بِهَذَا الْكِتَابِ أَقْوَامًا وَيَضَعُ بِهِ آخَرِينَ. Through the same book, Allah elevates some people. And the same book, Allah drops some people. You are connected to it, Allah elevates you. Look at those who are reciters of the Quran. We know them. We named so many of them. What is your connection with them? It's only that they can recite the Quran in a beautiful, melodious way. What is another connection? No other connection. There are Muslimin who can read the Quran. I've benefited from the recitation. I love this recitation. For example, Yunus Aswelis, a guy from North Africa. What a lovely recital. MashaAllah, Tabarakallah. A guy called Hassan Saleh, now based in America, reading so beautifully. What's my connection with these people? Nothing besides the word of Allah. So Allah elevates people through the Quran and then some are dropped through the same Quran. And that's why you find people, they spend their entire lives trying to find fault in the Quran. It started from the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They tried to find fault in the Quran, they couldn't. And they kept on picking on things, it's going to happen right to the end of time. If you're a Muslim and you don't know the response to something that someone has said against the Quran, you need to learn it. You don't just become impressed by someone who supposedly found a fault. There are no faults. There is no contradiction, not at all. But the unsuspecting, those who don't have knowledge, they might think that, oh, these guys are quite, you know, they've studied and they found some mistakes. No errors. No errors, not at all. May Allah Almighty grant us the ability to understand how gifted we are. It has in it the news of those before us, the news of those who are to come after us, and the rulings of whatever we may require in our current lives. This is what the Quran has in it. It has prophecies of the future, it has the stories of the past, and it has the rulings, rules and regulations that would apply presently. Everything is for a reason. And it is there because Allah wants to teach us lesson. I give you a quick example. There are thousands of prophets, those whom we know, those whom we don't know. Allah has mentioned in the Quran how many? 25. Someone said 25. Well done, well done, mashallah. How old are you? 13. 14. I thought you were 25, mashallah. Nonetheless, mashallah. Allah mentioned 25 prophets in the Quran. But how many prophets were there? Were there not thousands of them? Allah says, وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا مِن قَبْلِكَ رُسُلًا إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِمْ Allah says, before you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we sent messengers to their people. And in another verse, Allah says, مِنْهُمْ مَنْ قَصَصْنَا عَلَيْكَ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ لَمْ نَقْصُصْ عَلَيْكَ From among them, we told you some of them, some of their stories, and some of their stories we didn't even tell you. So if you look at the stories of the 25 alone that are in the Quran, which prophet of Allah is mentioned in the greatest detail in the Quran? Can you say his name? Musa alayhi salam, Moses, may Allah's peace and blessings be on him. Moses, may peace be upon him, mentioned the most in the Quran. And thereafter, who do you have? Isa alayhi salam, Ibrahim alayhi salam, and so many others. How many of them does Allah mention the difficulties they faced when they told their communities to come towards Allah? Not all of them. Allah didn't mention the details of all of them, of their risala or the nubuwah itself. Allah, for example, Yusuf alayhi salam, you know his story, the most amazing story, an entire surah named after the Prophet Joseph, may peace be upon him. So many powerful lessons for all of us to learn. But Allah did not mention the deep details of all of his da'wah and how the people harassed him and so on. It was concentrated on a certain point. The same applies to some other prophets of Allah. Allah mentioned some of them in great detail, some of their struggles when they went to their people. Nuh alayhi salam, Isa alayhi salam. Allah mentions much more detail about these prophets. With the Prophet Musa alayhi salam, Allah mentions so much. Now, why? Because Allah wants us to draw lesson from all of this. Some people will face different challenges, and all the messengers did not face exactly the same challenges. May Allah Almighty grant us an understanding. I heard someone say that Jesus in Islam, is more important than Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam because he was mentioned more in the Quran. He brought together two things that are not to be brought together. So what if Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not mentioned as much as Isa alayhi salam in the Quran? It doesn't make one more valuable than the other because of the number of times he was mentioned. If that was the case, then Musa alayhi salam should have been the most important. But that's not the case. And if that was the case, then Nuh alayhi salam should have been even more important, and so on. But that's not the case. So don't let someone fool you to tell you this is what this means and that's what that means. You need to know, you need to learn, you need to understand, you need to enjoy not just the recitation, the meaning. Look into it. You will learn so much that wallahi, it will grant you a knowledge of Allah in an unshakable way. That's why Allah says, قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ إِنَّمَا يَتَذَكَّرُ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ Are they equal, those who know and those who don't know? Are they equal, those who know and those who don't know? They're not equal. Indeed, Allah Almighty knows the ones with sound intellect and knowledge. It is a reminder for them, a remembrance for them. Subhanallah. They are the ones who take heed. And that's why Allah says, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. The true people who are conscious of Allah in the correct sense and they fear Him in the correct sense are those who have knowledge of Allah. You don't know who is Allah and you don't even know the message of Allah. You've never made an effort to learn it. How are you going to be conscious of Him, the Creator who created you? Allah says, you know what? We want you to learn. When you learn more, you will understand the beautiful names and qualities of Allah. I want to spend the next 10 minutes of my speech, which is the end of my speech, on something amazing. Look, we're struggling across the globe. Every one of us has our own struggles. The Quran will help you, calm you down. It will soothe you. It gives you a lot of comfort and positivity. It reminds you, and in the Quran, Allah has done everything in a unique, divine way. Allah starts the Quran with a certain verse. What is it? According to some scholars, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim is a verse of Surah Al-Fatiha. And according to others, it's not a verse of Surah Al-Fatiha, but you have to say it anyway before you start off reading Surah Al-Fatiha. So let's look at that. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. I want to start reading Quran. What do? I say, A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitanir Rajim. I seek the protection in Allah from Shaitan the accursed. Why do I do that? I do that because Allah says, فَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنَ فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. If you want to read the Quran, you need to seek the protection in Allah from Shaitan the accursed. I want the benefit of it. I don't want Shaitan to tamper. I want to be able to understand it. I don't want Shaitan to tamper, and so on. So I sought the protection in Allah from Shaitan the accursed, and then I say, بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ. I'm starting in the name of Allah. What does Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim mean? The merciful, the merciful. Two different types of mercy, right? The especially merciful and Subhanallah Rabbil Alameen. You can even say the most beneficent, the most merciful, the most merciful, the most merciful. Let me quickly tell you the difference between the two. Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim. Ar-Rahman is the all-encompassing mercy of Allah that includes the Muslim, the non-Muslim, and every other creature of Allah. Allah is so merciful that He is fully merciful. But Ar-Rahim is a special mercy that Allah has dedicated towards the believers. So Allah says, the one, the especially merciful is Ar-Rahim. Especially merciful for the believers, and the mercy that encompasses everything is Ar-Rahman. So Allah says, you should say, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, in the name of Allah, the one who is the most merciful, the especially merciful to the believers too. Subhanallah. When I start off that way, two things are highlighted, or three. Number one is, I started in the name of Allah because it's His word anyway. And whatever you do that you are supposed to be, that is a matter of importance, you should say Bismillah. Kullu amrin dhi balin lam yubtada'u fihi bismillahi fahuwa aqta. Anything important that you are starting without the name of Allah, you're chopping it off. You're not going to benefit the proper way. So when you're reading the Quran, you say Bismillah in the name of Allah. Then I'm saying, the most merciful. If Allah wanted, He could have decided to have a different name or quality of His. Is Ar-Rahman not a name of Allah? It is. You have a name of a human, Abdur Rahman, the slave of the most merciful. Abdur Rahim, the slave of the most merciful. Right? So Ar-Rahman and Rahim are the names of Allah. If Allah wanted, He could have said, the one who punishes, the one who is severe in his punishment. He could have said that. No, He wants you to understand He's merciful. When we start the Quran, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, the first thing we're starting is the praise of Allah. I'm praising Him. Praise who? Praise my Lord. He made me. I'm here. Indeed, all praise belongs to Him. Everything is the ownership of Allah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. I cannot start by avoiding the praise of Allah, I praise Allah in a holistic way. Alhamdu, all praise belongs to Allah. And who is Allah? The same two names and qualities that he named, that he mentioned earlier. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. If Allah wanted, it could have been different qualities. It could have been a quality where he mentions his anger, he mentions how severe he is and so on. But no, Allah Almighty chose to say, most merciful, most kind, most forgiving, most compassionate, that is your Lord. So I want to tell you, in the midst of all our struggles and all our suffering, never ever focus on negatives. Focus on the positives and improve yourself. Connect with Allah. Allah is most merciful. Allah is most kind. So many people think, I've committed so much of sin that I don't know if Allah will accept me. Wallahi, those thoughts are from shaitan. Because Allah is waiting to accept you and I. May Allah forgive me. May Allah forgive all of us. And may we start a new leaf in a beautiful way. So my brothers and sisters, here we are with the names of Allah that he chose right at the beginning, being the most beautiful of names, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. And so many times Allah speaks about how he is Ghafoor, Rahim, most forgiving, most merciful. Ghaffar, Tawwab, names of Allah mentioned in the Quran. Ghaffar means one who is oft forgiving. And like you and I, you forgive someone once, they do the same thing, you forgive them again, they do the same thing a third time, what happens? What happens? Yes, you won't forgive them. You become angry, upset. You want to roll up your sleeves and punch them. Spoke to Akhi Ayman the other day. He says, I'm not naked, my brother. I said, I know, none of us are naked. He said, you don't even know what I'm talking about. What was he talking about? I don't even know. Maybe he needs to explain to us. May Allah forgive all of us. I think he's talking about, you know, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. I am not naked because I have the Quran in me. It for me is a protection. It will protect me by the will of Allah. There goes. The question is, how much effort are we going to make to connect with Allah before we return to Allah? Here are the verses that Allah has revealed, giving us mercy, giving us hope in his mercy. Shaitan comes to us and say, no, you've done too much, you can't turn to him. People are struggling across the globe. Wallahi, if I don't change and if we don't change to become better people, to become amazing human beings that are pleased with Allah and Allah is pleased with them. When the Quran mentions the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, Allah speaks about two things. Radiallahu anhum wa radu anhu. Allah's pleased with them, they're pleased with Allah. Are we not pleased with Allah? Whatever condition he keeps us in, Allah will be pleased with us. I love the hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us, man ahabba liqa' Allahi ahabba Allahu liqa'ahu. Whoever loves the meeting with Allah, Allah loves the meeting with that person. I'm looking forward to meeting with Allah. Are you? Subhanallah. So Allah would be looking forward to meeting with you. And if you want to meet with Allah, prepare for that day by doing what? Lots of istighfar. Oh Allah, forgive me. I'm a human. I faltered. I did wrong things. I've really done some embarrassing things. Oh Allah, don't hold it against me. I love you. I worship you alone. Forgive me. I'm looking forward to the day that you're going to take me back. I'm going to worship you and you alone for the rest of my life. When I meet you, grant me the best of everything. And grant me the companionship of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Grant me the companionship of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah Almighty grant that to us. So you go through the verses of the Quran, you find the mercy of Allah, you find the goodness. Yes, there are warnings, there are reminders, but I tell you what, when you look at the mercy of Allah in the Quran, you immediately realize my Lord is the most kind, the most compassionate, the most amazing, the most loving, the most forgiving. That is Allah. He is my Lord. He is the one I'm going to turn to. Never allow anyone to make you become despondent as a result of a sin you've committed, something wrong you've done, or sometimes simply human nature. For as long as you know you're trying to please Allah, you know what's right and wrong, you're trying to focus, you're becoming a better person, you're seeking the forgiveness of Allah in preparation for the meeting with Allah, you're heading in the right direction. May Allah bless all of us. I really am so delighted to see these brothers and sisters all over, starting from that corner right at the top there, mashallah, all the way around to this corner, right at the top there. May Allah bless you all. أقول قولي هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.